If psychology has a birth date, it would probably be 1879. That year, a man named Wilhelm Wundt established a lab at the University of Leipzig in Germany to explore psychological experiments. Because of this, Wundt is usually credited as being the father of experimental psychology, and many people even credit him as being the father of modern psychology as well. The work that Wundt created influenced those students that worked under him and formed the beginning of the first perspective in psychology, called structuralism or structural psychology. Because this perspective was founded in Germany, many of the early adherents to structuralism were Europeans. Their perspective on psychology was to find the basic building blocks of a person's psychology. You can think of it as being like how a chemist may break down matter into molecules and atoms, then break down those atoms into their components. Or how a physicist may explore natural laws that govern how the world works, like gravity. In fact, you can think of structuralism as being an attempt to marry philosophy with physics. They tried to find underlying universal causes of psychological phenomena. So if someone was depressed, we can explore that feeling deeper and find the internal factors that were causing it. The focus of structuralism was very much on internal mental activities. They employed a procedure called introspection, or sometimes it's called internal perception, to try to determine common causes of psychological phenomena. Introspection involved a person looking within themselves as objectively as possible. Structuralism thought that the biggest problem with studying psychology was that it involved people, and people always like to include their subjective experiences. We love to talk about our opinions, our emotions, assumptions, and all kinds of other things. The problem with this is that everyone is different and has their own subjective experiences, which can make it difficult to find these common connections that the structuralists were really trying to find. So, a good way of describing structuralism's view of psychology was that to study psychology, we must remove people's subjective experiences in order to discover the objective causes. Once they could do that, they could find the common causes that explain our psychology. This makes sense because it is largely what most other sciences do. A good analogy for this would be if I wanted to know how a computer works, I can break it apart and look at all of its components. So I can open the monitor and the tower, break apart circuit boards, remove wires. But at some point, what I end up with is just a pile of parts that aren't really a computer anymore. This is the reason why structuralism isn't really around too much today, and is usually considered a historical perspective. It had a fatal flaw in its view of what psychology is. Humans are the sum of all the things coming together that make us who we are, and that sum is greater than all the parts that go into it. Psychology also can't completely remove itself from subjective experiences. There is even a saying in psychology that perspective is everything. What a person feels, believes, or thinks can become that person's reality. Structuralism's focus on internal aspects of our psychology was largely replaced by a later field in psychology that I'll talk about in another video. That field is called psychoanalytical psychology. Introspection is also still used today to help people find the deeper reasons behind their psychological problems. While Wilhelm Wundt was busy creating structuralism in Europe, there was a different perspective in psychology taking root in the United States. This perspective in psychology focused much more on observable behaviors rather than internal mechanisms. It was called functionalism, or functional psychology. Many American scientists were instrumental in the creation of this perspective, and it was largely opposed to much of the work that the structuralist psychologists were actually doing at the time. The reason for this was that functionalists understood that there was a lot of difficulty involved in separating the subjective and objective experiences people have. They also understood that many of the things that structuralists wanted to do was far beyond the scope of science at that time. To be perfectly honest, it's kind of far beyond the scope of what science is capable of doing today. Because of the difficulties involved with studying internal psychological phenomena, they decided to focus instead on what they can directly observe. Because of this, they focused more on behavior. Functionalism was also really strongly influenced by Charles Darwin and his theory of natural selection. Now, this isn't a class on evolution or biology, but just to give you a brief review, natural selection says that any organism adapts to their environment through developing traits to make them better able to survive and to reproduce. So basically, traits that are beneficial to our survival or reproductive success get passed on, and those that don't die off. Usually, when people think of this natural selection, they think in terms of things like physical traits. However, functionalism also applied this to psychological traits and behaviors. For example, they would argue that something like anxiety is so common because, in some ways, having anxiety may make a person better able to survive. Maybe people with anxiety are always on guard for threats, which makes them better able to respond and survive to threats when they present themselves. Now, I want to be clear that I'm not saying that this is true. I'm just saying that this is what functionalists believed. Functionalism really relied heavily on this idea that all behavior is based on an evolutionary benefit. And this is where it goes off the rails a little bit. To put it in other words, people, you, me, all of us, are kind of stupid. We do dumb stuff all the time. I call it the "hey y'all, watch this" or the "hold my beer" phenomenon. Let me give you some examples. Texting and driving is a behavior. It's a bad behavior and one that can be seriously dangerous. Every year, tons of accidents and deaths can be linked to people driving a car while texting. Yet, a lot of people do it. How about things like consuming substances that can be bad for us? Things like overeating, drinking alcohol, or smoking. All bad behaviors that can impair your health, yet plenty of folks do it. This is the reason why functionalism, like structuralism, isn't really around anymore. It can't explain all the behaviors people do, just some of them. In psychology, we don't just look at the beneficial or the good, we look at every aspect of a person's psychology. The good, the bad, and sometimes even the ugly. Now, just like how I mentioned that structuralism was largely replaced by psychoanalytical psychology in its focus on the internal aspects of psychology, functionalism was largely replaced by behaviorism in its focus on the observable external aspects of psychology. This is why I refer to these perspectives as being historical. They're not really around anymore other than talking about them and the role that they played in influencing later, more relevant perspectives. Thanks for watching, everybody.